what is your temple? And how do you want us to be the best here? So please be with us in this hour of study in Jesus' name. Amen. So what is cancer? You know very well. It's disease that caused by an uncontrolled division of abnormal cells in a part of the body. And four mechanisms are involved in tumor growth and spreading. Actually, several of them. The first one that is characteristic for cancer cells is that they can stimulate their own growth. And they suppress the genes that inhibit excessive cell proliferation. You know, the cancer cell, they don't respect others. And in which sense? Well, you know, when we get a cut on our skin, then, you know, the scar forms and the cells begin to multiply, to close up, this epithelium closes it, and then it stops. You know, once the certain density of cells is reached, the cell division stops, because there are sensors that tell us, well, there's enough neighborhood. Cancer cells don't have this neighborhood. They don't respect others. They want to multiply themselves. And that's why we get the tumor. So it ignores body signals to stop growth and division and stimulates body to provide it with blood supply. Another interesting thing, the tumor, original tumor, cannot grow beyond 1 millimeter or 2 millimeters without additional blood supply. Process called angiogenesis. I'm looking for that a little later. It just, at first, it just relies on whatever seeps through the interstitial fluid that nourishes it, but it's not enough. And that's why cancer may exist for decades, in fact, like melanoma, without spreading, without growing, virtually. Because it needs blood supply. And has potential to multiply endlessly. Did you hear that they call cancer cells immortal? Kind of eerie, a little bit. So they also poorly differentiated. So these are the kind of cells that just concerned about their existence. They don't concern about job. They don't concern about performing anything. They just concern about existence and nutrition. So they inhibit genes that trigger programmed cell death. They don't want to die. They don't want to die. Now let's look at several steps. This is common. Cancer, example of cancer in the colon. You know, the number one killer for men is lung cancer. Number two is prostate cancer. And for women, number one is breast cancer and then lung cancer also. The third position, colorectal cancer, takes. And let's look how it starts. So these are normal cells, and then they begin to enlarge and multiply in response to irritation. What kind of irritation do they encounter in colon? Well, bile, low fiber. You know, if we don't have enough fiber and we consume a lot of fats, to break down fats, we need bile. And bile is an irritant, it's a strong irritant. And so it will irritate the lining of our colon big time. And so, actually, this process of hypertrophy and hyperplasia, this is the response of our mucosa in colon to protect ourselves. So this change doesn't take place without reason. Now, looks like, let's look at another stage, metaplasia. This is the stage where there are still normal cells. These are the cells that can be found in the body elsewhere, but not in this particular place. So now the next metamorphosis that takes place is that the cells themselves, they change in their structure. And they now resemble already different cells that would be more stable. They would be more resilient for this irritation. But they are not in the right place. And look at the next stage. That's a bad one. The dysplasia. That's when the cells are not cancerous yet, but they already cannot be found anywhere in the Bible. But they are still not done. But this is the last stage. That's the last step. And what's the next one? That's actually the cancer cells. That's the malignant and the plasma. And that's the one that can metastasize.
So you want to hope that you get your colonoscopy
before
and follow with a metaplasia rather than a dysplasia or malignancy.
Right. At least dysplasia, you know. That's the latest. Or the cervical cancer in the same way. Okay. What are our best defense? You know, we would think immune system, but it's actually not. Our best defense is within cell. This is our main place where we want to contain it and eliminate it. And let's look how it works. So, the best defense against cancer lies within each cell of human body and not with the specialized cells of immune system. That's already when this cancer metastasizes and the body has to catch up because it's nowhere. But this includes the repair of certain types of DNA damage, and we'll look into that in a second, as well as mechanisms that prevent the survival and division of cells with badly damaged DNA. Now, that's an interesting statement. But to understand it better, we will look at the cell division. So this is our cell cycle, and it starts right here. With G0 is the stage of resting state. Cell is doing its work, it's not concerned about dividing, it's just doing what it has to do. And then it starts moving toward the division of DNA as the first step. And look, there is a certain amount of time that is allotted to the cell where it can change its mind and go back into resting state. But once it passed this one, as you can see here, it has no reverse. It has only forward. And so now it moves and it prepares for the division of DNA. Now, there are three checkpoints here. And we'll see how important they are. First checkpoint is to make sure that all the building blocks are in place, that they are all good, and they are ready for the division of DNA. Okay, so here we have S stage, is the division of DNA, and once the division of DNA took place, there's another checkpoint. The body now is checking, did we do the right job? Was the job done good? And once the job done good, it moves on. But what if it's not? There are two ways that the body handles it. It either gives more time to fix it, or if it sees that, hey, I can't fix it. And that's like sometimes we're trying to remember something, and if we get some time enough, we'll remember it. But sometimes we just can't remember anything. And so, here we can see that the body gives time, and if cell cannot repair it, just to die. There's no other choice. It's called apoptosis or control program death. The cell is destroyed. Because the cancer heavily relies on mutations, and another mutation, and another mutation. It's a random process. So actually, it's a difficult job for cancer to develop. It's a hard job for cancer to develop. Not only to develop, but then to survive once it metastasizes. It's a very hostile environment for cancer cells. So, you know, we have to really appreciate the fact that it's a hard job. Cancer to develop. That's why it takes years and years and years and years of mutations until finally that one cell, it's actually starts with one cell, that one cell survives and it multiplies and multiplies and multiplies. Okay, so once the division of DNA successfully took place, what's the next stage? Well, now the next stage is actually to divide the cell. Well, now imagine if this, once this checkpoint is passed and the body, the cell says, okay, this good cell, I got a whooping dose of radiation, or maybe some other toxin. By the way, you know, in one word, the cause of cancer, irritation, either chemical or physical. If I would be rubbing and rubbing and rubbing endlessly, let's say my gum, what I can get? Cancer. Yeah, improperly fit dentures can cause like cancer of the mouth. So that's an example of physical. Huh?
Irritation and what?
Irritation either chemical or physical. Okay. Physical, we brought example of 40 feet of dangers. Or chemical irritation, we just looked at the example of cancer of the colon. You know, in the bile, in the absence of fiber, you know, some people, they defecate on a bowel movement once a week. Once a week, I'm not a person. Once a week, what does it tell? That's a lot of irritation. There's a lot of bile, you know, that stuff has to go, you know, things has to move. And now, let's say if the, at this point, when everything was checked and seemed right, I got radiation. Well, there's no already reverse. So that mutated DNA or changed DNA will continue into the next cell cycle. Maybe it will even continue to the next cell cycle. And so there are cancers that require fewer mutations, other cancers require more mutations, and it's estimated that between 4 and 5 critical mutations in DNA is required for the cancer to develop. That's why it takes often decades for the cancer to develop. But if it's leukemia, like childhood leukemia, it requires fewer, maybe 3 only. Why? Well, because bone marrow cells, they multiply really fast. They divide really fast. In child, when it's born, the rate is amazing. Very fast cell divides. And of course, that's when the things can go wrong much faster. Okay? But other types of cancer, like prostate cancer, is very slow. Some types of breast cancer also, very slow. So against them, radiation would work very well, unless it's a fast dividing cells and fast progressing cancer. So the faster progressing cancer, the better radiation would work. But if it's a very slow cancer, radiation won't do very good for it. Okay.
Okay. Is that at a certain stage? I understand about the leukemia, but once it gets to a certain stage, does it?
So
even faster once it gets to, like, if it's initially at stage one, is it slower to get to stage two? But once you get to stage two,
That's a good question. That's a good question, because with some cancers, the progression may actually speed up, because certain genes that are responsible for the checking and suppression, for example, this next one is P53. In 50% of cancer patients, this gene is turned off. And what does it what is it responsible for? To induce apoptosis. If something goes wrong, it has to say cell, you have to die. But if this cell, if this protein is off, well, guess what? Then the next mutation will go faster, because this protein is off, so it allows faulty cell to replicate, to continue accumulate mutation without dying.
What part is it keep on off?
I'm sorry.
What part is it keep on off?
Okay, let's go. This is actually, we'll discuss this a little further.
You are reminded that you should hold your questions and ask them.
Yeah, because some of your questions, that's right, thank you. If you wait 2-3 minutes, your question may be answered. Okay? So let's wait until the end. Okay, so we looked at that, and we mentioned about how many mutations, and here is another point. We have genes that are called proto-oncogenes. These are genes, these are normal genes, 12 of them, we need them, about 100 of them. They are responsible for the stimulation of cell division. But once these proto-oncogenes get mutated, they turn into oncogenes. And the mutant form of proto-oncogenes will contribute to malignant transformation, and they will become already oncogenes. The second class is of genes involved in cellular transformation called tumor suppressor genes, because what they do, they prevent the unwanted proliferation of the mutant cells. And the typical one was P53. So we don't have to be afraid of age, because there is certain genetic and environmental factors that we can actually manipulate. Unfortunately, you know, many people, they know about, you know, you don't have to expose yourself to the sun too much, you don't have to smoke too much, but they still do this. Even knowing, they still do this, and by doing it, they increase their chances. If you look at this man, what unusual do you see here? Exactly. Oh, this man. Okay, guess why? That's right. The sister knows. See, this man was a truck driver. This man also. Did you know that we usually get cancer on our face on the side, on one side, on the left side? That's mainly on the left side. Why? Because that's the side that is exposed to the window when we are driving. Good. Take note, right, of that. Close yourself from the sun. Okay, so what are the cancerogens? Due to the chemical and physical agents that damage DNA. And 90 to 95% of cancers related to the environment, see, diet, tobacco, infection, overweight, and so forth, and only 5 to 10 directly connected to the genes. But now, once cancer is developed, what are we going to rely on? Well, we have an army. We still have an army, and we have a hope. And that army are the white blood cells, especially killer cells, your lymphocytes, that will seek and destroy. Cancer is sometimes not manifest itself. You know, the cancer may exist and evade our white blood cells. White blood cells are the ones that they're immune cells that destroy pathogens, and it can hide. You know, there are two types of cancer cells. Some of them have a flag and they're saying, I don't belong to you. But there are cancer cells that are so sneaky, they're saying, well, I'm not going to show any flag. And so they're trying to hide themselves. They're not manifesting any proteins on their surface and hoping that that will prevent them from being destroyed. But we have a specialized cells called killer cells, T killer cells that hunt for the cells without the flag, so to say. Now, what are symptoms and signs? Well, self-examination, you know, we have to know how to check our breast, testicles for men, for lumps and swellings. Recurrent fever that persists for weeks can be a sign of leukemia. Fullness and swelling of face and neck can be caused by lung cancer. But there are many other reasons, but like hypothyroid may cause it as well. But changing bowel habits on a regular basis. Loose stool constipation, that also, of course, can be connected to hypo hyperthyroidism, as you heard from Tuesday. Presence of blood in the stool. You know, they're saying, don't wait to that. That's a bad time. That's a bad sign. And sometimes it's already hard to do anything once you have blood in the stool. There have been many years that, you know, natural remedies were used for cancers. And any doctor will agree. The way I live today may eventually bring me to a cancer. But not many of them understand that the way I live and the way I eat may actually take me out of cancer. And so when I was diagnosed with cancer, I should not quickly go for burn, poison, or cut. Because if it's a slow progressing cancer, I may first try something else. You know, I may change my diet, I may try to do some herbs and hydrotherapy, and then see, you know, maybe my tumor will shrink. In fact, we had a woman here that, you see, the protocol is if, let's say, we have breast cancer, then first they pre-treat her with chemo and radiation, then they cut it, and then again, chemo and radiation. Why did they do chemo and radiation in the first place? To shrink it, to shrink the tumor. And guess what happened? She came to us, she went through the program, and the tumor shrank. So when she came back to her oncologist, he looked and he said, oh wow, your tumor actually shrank. I don't need to give you chemo and radiation before the surgery. You know, that's a blessing already, because it will be hard for you to find a surgeon that would do that. They have to follow the protocol. They have to give you chemotherapy. And so it's advantage because your immune system will be under way less stress because radiation and chemo, they suppress the immune system. And that's why the secondary cancers appear later, because of the suppression of the immune system. Okay. Let me tell you one illustration. There were two women that got their kidney transplants from a donor. Donor died, so they shared kidneys. And within 2 years, both of them died from metastatic melanoma. Now guess where they got that metastatic melanoma? That woman was already 16 years in remission from metastatic melanoma. She was diagnosed cancer-free. Or was she actually cancer-free? No. No, and you know what state she was? She was in a state of equilibrium. That means her immune system were able to suppress those cancer cells that were still there and keep them under control. Does it answer your question? Why sometimes cancer come in revenge? And you know, when it comes second time, it often kills. Like, I met one person, she had ovarian cancer. Oh, it's the worst second cancer for the woman. It's a very fast. But she was able to take it under control. She went on this, you know, juicing greens and completely changed her diet and lifestyle. And then about a year later, I met his sister and she said, unfortunately, my sister died because her cancer came back, because she returned to her previous lifestyle. And what does it tell us? Is that when you are declared to be cancer-free, you're not actually cancer-free, but it means that they cannot detect with the equipment that they have the presence of cancer cells, but it means that you have to be still vigilant for the rest of your life. See, this woman, 16 years afterward, down the road, and she still had cancer cells. And why those women developed it very fast? Well, because when they received the kidneys, they had to be put on prednisone. The immune system had to be suppressed. And that was advantageous, of course, for the cancer cells.
And did they catch the cancer
from the kidneys? Is there any connection between diet and cancer? 70% of cancer in Western population can be attributed to diet and lifestyle, with exposure to tobacco product, the major single contributor, 30%. This is from Journal of National Cancer Institute. We have modern billion smokers, lotions, soaps, all this health and beauty products that we put on our skin, which is, by the way, the largest organ, are readily absorbed, and they act as xenoestrogens. What are xenoestrogens? These are chemicals, petroleum products, that act like estrogens, but they're even more powerful than estrogens. And any doctor will tell you that breast cancer is primarily caused by estrogen, it's fueled by estrogen. I mean, cervical cancer, endometriosis, you name it, they are fueled by estrogens. So you have to watch for that. If you have health food store nearby, I will really encourage you. Get the natural soaps, lotions. Okay, what are the steps to fight cancer? Lower animal protein. This calorie-restricted diet, you know, is actually works good for brain tumors. And how did they discover it? There's a medical journal called Epilepsia. And a medical institute called John Hopkins Institute, where they treat children with epilepsy already for a long time. And this is what they found, that when they put them on the calorie-restricting diet, it means they cut on carbohydrates and they increase fats and proteins in their diet, what it does, it improves symptoms of epilepsy dramatically. But it also, it happened to slow down and manage, better manage the brain tumors. Why? We all passed it at one point of life, either voluntarily or we just had to do that. And normally the main source of fuel for our brain is what? Glucose, right? But when we fast, the brain gradually, the healthy cells of the brain, they gradually switch within 3 days, about 2-3 days, to alternative fuel called ketone bodies that are made from fat. But what happens with the tumors, with the cancer cells, they are poorly adapted to switch from glucose to ketones. And that's how you get that. See, that's how you can take under control the brain tumor cells growth. Of course, you need to regulate any chronic inflammation in your body with nutrients, foods, herbs. Take special care of the omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. Where do they come from? Where does omega-3 come from? Right, in the fish or flax seed or walnuts. There's also in soybean oil. There's some in canola also, but with canola you have to be careful because it's often in the GMO. It has to be organic. But also it's a high source of omega-3. What are the sources of omega-6? Well, look at this, arachidonic acid. That comes exclusively from animal sources. And what it does, it produces pro-inflammatory prostaglandins. These are short-lived but very powerful hormones that cause pain. And linoleic acid as well. The sources of linoleic acid would be sunflower oil. These are the examples of linoleic acid. Now, there has to be a balance. 3 to 1, not more than that. Guess what's the average balance in America? 10 to 1. So you can guess what is the condition and how many of these pro-inflammatory prostaglandins are flooding the body. And inflammation, chronic inflammation is an irritant. So we just have to go for the increase of the flaxseed, you know, grind it, add it to your salad. Reduce levels of free radical damage, oxidation, balance hormones, estrogen dominance. It's for why women around 60 get breast cancer usually. Well, that's because they are no longer producing progesterone, they're no longer ovulating. And the fat cells, they're still converting androgenic hormones into estrogen, and where the androgenic hormone comes from adrenal glands. See? So we have a lot of estrogen still, and low we get in trouble. So we have to take under control what? You know, weight and what kind of oils we consume as well, because that's all the building blocks for the fats and for the pro-inflammatory prostaglandins. So reducing chemical overload. Food-specific nutrients and plant medicine can assist with detoxification of these chemicals and improve immune function. Yeah, that's a whole another subject, detoxification. Japanese diet, look at this, predisposes to what? High risk of stomach cancer from pickles. They love pickle food. In Africa, liver cancer is quite prevalent in areas where they consume a lot of peanuts. While peanuts are growing in the ground, in the soil, they tend to get moldy. Mold produces aflatoxins. Aflatoxins damage liver. In 1997 report, the recommendation already suggested already back then that vegetable, fruits, and whole grain cereals would decrease the risk of a variety of cancers. That's an official source, World Cancer Research Fund and American Institute. But in 1997, they already was telling this. Wow, this is a stunning statement. That report shows that increasing the consumption of vegetables and fruits from 250 to as little as 400 grams per day, that means just an apple and a banana, may be associated with 23% decreased risk of cancers worldwide. Can you imagine, one-fourth of the cancers will be eliminated, just an apple and banana per day. So this is how important the health of my health. In Netherlands, they compared 111 biliary tract cancer patients with 480 controls. And look what they found. The cancer risk associated with intake of sugars, independent of other energy sources, more than double for the cancer patients with higher intake of sugars. Why sugars are cancerogenic? Because they suppress the immune system. Next, there was an epidemiological study in 21 modern countries, and they revealed that sugar intake is a strong risk factor that contributes to higher breast cancer rates. Breast cancer rates. Again, for the same reason. Okay, so how do we treat them? Well, there is this plant, rooibos. We sell it at Country Life. It's rich in this substance, EGCG. When I worked at Country Life, I had so many men, especially men, they would come, they would have prostate issue, they would hunt for this EGCG. We would sell out in no time often because it's a very powerful antioxidant, it's a good protector against cancer, and it is found in green tea, but we would recommend the one without caffeine. And you can find this without caffeine. But guess what? This very substance, picolocatechin regalate, EGCG, can be found in this rooibos tea. You know, with Alvita brand, Alvita tea, they sell it. It has very powerful anti-inflammatory activity. And look, I'm not just telling on myself, I'm quoting you the medical journals. See? It's a polyphenol that induces what? Apoptosis. That means controlled cell death of the cancer cells. Just make sure it's caffeine free.
For prostate?
Yeah, it works very well for prostate, but it would work also for others, for other cells, for other types of cancers. They did a specific test on the vascular smooth muscle cells. Okay. Here's the dosage. I won't go over the dosage. You can just, you know, once you get the presentation, you can look into it yourself. Garlic, 85 grams of garlic, onion, chives, and so forth, reduces stomach cancer by 40%. And what do they do? They modulate macrophage and T lymphocyte function. That means they stimulate the white blood cells. Again, you know, garlic lowers stomach cancers. Probably because it takes under control H. pylori, which causes ulcers, gastric ulcers. Help destroy cancerous cells in much the same way as chemotherapeutic drugs without side effects. Here's the compounds in the garlic. Ahoin, there's another one. Here is alanine and ahoin receptor 1, 2. And here's the, basically the medical research, you know, the study from medical journals that prove that they do work. You know, they do make difference. And you can get this allicin just as an extract, you know, in a pill form, or just steam garlic, you know, for me, a minute and a half, and you can take the garlic itself. So just to take away the bite. Some mushrooms work against cancers as well as the Japanese mushrooms. Maitake, reishi, shiitake. Aloe vera, high polysaccharides as well, reduces, look at the tumor mass in some types of cancer. In Journal of Ethnopharmacology. They did study on aloe vera gel. And look, it's 1999. I wish they would do more studies like that.
So are you taking that internally or putting it on the tumor?
Right, internally, orally. Juice consumed orally reduces tumor mass.
It's interesting because the FDA is taking it off the market because of colon cancers.
They took it off the market?
They took it because of the increased risk of colon cancer?
Increased risk of colon cancer because aloe vera? Well, look at this study in 1999, I guess maybe some conflicting studies. But it works against some cancers. Okay, soy. Wow, that's a, quite a debating issue. But why Chinese women hardly even know what breast cancer is? Well, it's one of the facts is that they consume over 85 grams of soy every day in tofu, you know, soy milk, miso, and so forth. You know, if I will just drink some soy milk over, put some soy milk over my cereal twice a week, you know, that won't work. It has to be quite a more substantial amount. And they do reduce the breast cancer risk, and this is, you know, Lancet. Lancet is one of the top medical journals. Soy intake and breast cancer risk in Singapore, so Chinese study, British Journal of Cancer. You know, this is something we can't just overlook, and it's 2008, quite the first study. Soy also showed protection against prostate cancer in men who ate it daily. Prostate cancer is low in men who eat soy protein regularly. It decreases dehydrated testosterone. You know, it takes testosterone, then with 5-alpha-reductase enzyme, it is converted into dehydrated testosterone, which is 10 times more powerful. And it stimulates cancer, prostate cancer, the excess of which is a contributing factor in prostate disease. There's another enzyme, aromatase, but that converts androgenic hormones into estrogens. And then estrogens also play a factor in prostate cancer because they create free radicals. And in that way, they can damage prostate. So we have to take control. Because men, as we are aging, we tend to have more estrogen. Women, they're aging, you know, they also tend to have more estrogen, but also androgenic hormones increasing. Cruciferous vegetables, what good in them? Research indicates their potential value as chemo-preventive agent for breast cancer, and it's called indole-3-carbinol. This substance, it's also, by the way, sold as a supplement, but you can just take it with vegetables. And what does it do? It modulates estrogen receptors. It basically turns them off. Okay, this is the dosage. We won't talk about that. You'll just, once you get the presentation, you'll see the dosage. So eating at least 5 servings of vegetables and 2 servings of fruit per day, 1 serving is 100 grams, is an excellent and tasty way to maintain your health. How many grams of fiber do we need? 30-35 grams of fiber per day. It's very important. Okay, so as we already said, that the fiber is important to promote, to stimulate peristalsis in the colon and also in the small intestine. And there are some other reasons as well. You know, it absorbs the bile, absorbs the irritants in. We have to stay on a lowish calorie diet side, but adequate, you know. If somebody is just only in the office and somebody else is working in the field, there is a different calorie intake right there. So remember to stay away from unsafe cleaning materials. Try to, you know, stay with something natural. Sun, you know, you have to protect yourself. Because skin cancer is number one, is the most common cancer. It's not the number one killer, but it's the most common one. Vitamin D, why? Because it activates T cells. It's very important. It stimulates the T cells, it signals them to do the right job. There's the active form, D3. Rest. You know, a lot of diseases in our body are related to stress. You know, autoimmune diseases. You know, melatonin is the most important antioxidant, is the most powerful one. And there's also glutathione. But melatonin is extremely important. And when do we get it? Once we fall asleep, there is this spike in melatonin. and then it kind of goes down and stays really low unless somebody else wakes up and again, it's a small spike. Time is important, you know, we don't want to wait, we want to take care of the cancer as soon as possible. And one more process, angiogenesis, this triggering of the growth of the blood vessels. Let's look at this. This is how it looks. You know, just by looking at these blood vessels, you can tell they're not made the right way. And that's true, they're not. They're just made to deliver the blood. They are not really strong, they are really weak, these blood vessels. But they serve for, sorry, but they serve the purpose. They serve the purpose. And they create this additional nutrition. Now look at this process, angiogenesis. There are certain drugs that inhibit it. And here to the right is the high percentage of the growth. To the left, the closer to the left side, it means that the more powerful is the agent and the less growth of this blood vessels. So irinotecan would be the most powerful. This is the cancer drug. You know, there's simvastatin, celecoxib, and so forth. So they include it in chemotherapy to block this growth of the blood vessels. But look here, soy extract. And then artichoke, and parsley, and berries, and garlic look better than dexamethasone or pravastatin, you know, more than some drugs. So what it tells us, that, you know, once we have this healthy, balanced diet, you know, our body is able to take care of the cancer cells, because cancer cells appear every day in our body, every day. But we just don't know about them, because they're destroyed right there. Spot. So that's why it's important to include all these principles that we have. Any questions? Do you have any questions? Did I answer all of them?
You said that you should get vaccine and bring it. Is that good for men?
Oh, yes. Now
I understand that it is said now that.
Okay, yes, I'll understand. There was a study done in Finland, and what they found, men who consumed too much flaxseed oil had a higher rate of prostate cancer. But, right, oil. But guess what? Too much of anything is not good anyway. You name it. I mean, insulin, you know, thyroid hormone, we all need in just the right amount. If I get myself too much insulin, it's cancerogenic too. See? So, but if you will be very low on omega-3, then the pro-inflammatory processes will dominate over the anti-inflammatory process. Do we need inflammation in the body? Yes, we do. We need inflammation. That's why this man in this Finnish study in Finland, this study had a higher rate of the prostate cancer because they consumed too much flaxseed oil. They were suppressing the inflammation. And inflammation is important because that's, you know, inflammation defines the activity of your white blood cells. Without inflammation, they're not really active because there is no these kinins, these are chemicals that are released by cells as a cry for help. And if these pro-inflammatory factors are not released, then how do white blood cells know there is something going on there? That's why there's a higher rate.
Mm-hmm. So then it's better to use the ground
vaccine
than the oil.
Right, because it's hard to overdo when you just, you know, sprinkle a tablespoon or two over your cereal or whatever during the day, then, you know, consuming, you know, tablespoons of flaxseed oil. You know, the flaxseed oil in a therapeutical way can be increased for a short time. You know, there are some people that, for example, struggling with excessive inflammation in their body. For the therapeutical purpose, it will work. But if we're talking on the regular day-to-day basis, it's more practical to just grind the flaxseed oil. But as I said, for example, women with endometriosis, horrific pain. I mean, they can be basically debilitated for like 25 days out of the month, for them it would work very good because it will suppress the inflammation. But as I said, they on the day, and they need a larger dosage too. You know, in some conditions you need a larger dosage, but on day to day, you need
travel. I just want to add something to what you said. A lot of people buy the flaxseed already grounded. You should buy the whole seed, and when you need it, you ground it because it gets rancid after time.
Right, that's another point. That it's so best to keep flaxseed oil literally in the freezer, not in the refrigerator.
In the freezer?
Yes, in a freezer. And because in that way, even if you open the bottle in about a year, it can still stay without oxidation. Because you know, you probably notice if the bottle sits for a while, even in the refrigerator, it gets this fishy flavor, that means it's no good. But if you keep it in the freezer, you know, these are the polyunsaturated fatty acids, you know, they do not freeze that readily. I mean, they do, but it is still, you know, at least overnight, you need to keep it in the freezer. That's what I do. And it just takes sometimes just a minute, and it's already liquid. You know, you take it outside, and it's after about a minute.
Why do we see the debate on soy? You stated earlier that 85 grams per day is taken by
The medical community is split on this issue. Why? Because here, normally, if a woman has breast cancer, then the doctor will tell her 100% stay away from soy. Because there are some that say soy is bad for cancers, and others say soy is good for cancer. And you know where the truth is? The truth is not whether it's bad or whether it's good, but how much. That's the right answer. To get it work for you, you have to consume large amounts of it, over 85 grams. Now, we normally don't do that. You see, it has to be a large amount to be inhibited. Who is going to measure those phytoestrogens? That's really hard to do, because normal tests only measure estradiol, human estrogen, but not the phytoestrogen. So it's really hard to monitor. And if it's hard to monitor, you know, you have to be careful once you put the cancer away.
But, I mean, the way North America processes soy, could that be why it has a more of a negative impact on us? Because I know some people in Asia, stuff is made, soy is made and is eaten immediately versus you store for a long period of time, like how we consume things here in America.
There are two factors that involve this, GMO or non-GMO, and also they really eat actually. Also, there is amount of phytic acid that plays a role. Soy is high in phytic acid. What does it do? It competes for the absorption of, it binds the minerals, which are important actually for our health. So, actually, soy is known to bind, you know, calcium, you name it, copper, zinc. It reacts with it, and it has a tendency to bind. Then. So in those countries, they primarily eat either tofu, a lot of tofu, which has already like 50% less of phytic acid, or they eat fermented products. Even though we are not encouraging here any fermented products, but to the point that fermented products they have even less. In fact, they have the smallest amount of phytic acid, but you know, the tofu is good. With the fresh soy, you have to be a little more careful. You have to either cook it for a very long time to deactivate that phytic acid. Because if you know, if you just soak them for a long time, not to say for at least, you know, overnight or something like that. But just to get the soy and to make quickly soy milk from it and drink, you'll get all the phytic acid. Yes, ma'am.
One question I had was, can you have too many white blood cells?
It's an interesting question, because vegetarians and vegans, they have significantly less white blood cells than meat eaters, for example. The reason why, because we believe we have just less toxins and less inflammation in the body. Having too much white blood cells. You know, body regulates the amount. He can increase the amount of white blood cells, and usually increase the amount of white blood cells, you know, when it's like 10, 12 pounds, it's really high. That's an indication that person is sick. You're dealing with some sort of pathogens or leukemia, you know, when it just goes uncontrolled. So we tend to look at the immune system as, you know, vegetarians and vegans being a little less active. Why? Because less, a small amount of white blood cells, because we have less inflammation going on in our body. You know, it's like you always have it redded up, being as an animal, carnivorous, so to say. So immune system kind of a little pushes a little over, a little more than normally. And I believe that's what it should be, because it's a good sign, actually. You would think, well, the more white blood cells, maybe I'll be healthy. Actually, no. In some cases, to have a cold before the cancer surgery, there are studies that show that those people actually, their survival rate is higher. Why? Because they had the highest numbers of white blood cells before the cancer surgery. Okay, and I'm sorry, I'm already, we're kind of going over the time. So I really appreciate, I have to...
Just one.
One more question.
Just one, because we need to walk.
Oh my, I have two. Okay, just quickly, cancer and stress, cancer and hypothyroidism. Could you speak to
that? Okay. The hypothyroidism, well, stress, you know, obviously, stress is a huge load on the body. Stress can trigger, for example, autoimmune diseases. You know, stress can lead eventually to the imbalance in your chemistry in the body. In which way? You know, when I'm stressed out, then, for example, cortisol, which is a stress hormone, is released, and it's known to be elevated in people who are chronically stressed out. What does cortisol do? It lowers down actually the immune system. It lowers down the immune system. So not only we're wearing out our adrenals and you know, making them to produce a lot of stress hormones, but also we are working against ourselves by suppressing our immune system in that way. And we know what that can do. Now, you said the hypothyroidism, or hypothyroid and stress.
Cancer.
Oh, I'm sorry, cancer. So, is there any connection between cancer and hypothyroidism? Well, you know, if there would be, when it comes to hypothyroidism or any disorder of the thyroid, there is primary and there is a secondary cause. There is an intrinsic problem within the thyroid itself, or it can be secondary when there is a damage in the brain, like in the pituitary gland, and it's, let's say, overproducing thyroid stimulating hormone, or it actually, there is a symptom where the pituitary thyroid is just not functioning well, and it's understimulating it. So it may cause also the hypothyroidism. Now, I'm not sure if there is a direct connection between hypothyroidism and hypothyroidism and cancer, because what usually, what actually causes the cancer is, or the strong indication of the cancer is the heart nodules. See, there are cold nodules and there are hot nodules. And if they're cold, if they're not producing much, actually there's less chances that there is cancer there. There is an alert, or the doctor will do biopsy. He won't do even biopsy of the cold nodules, but he will biopsy hot nodules. So actually a hypothyroid has less chances to be cancerous than overthyroid. Okay, did I answer the question?
Hypo.
Yeah, hypo would be have the less chances that to become cancer. Hyper, more likely, yes. Because those hot nodules, they will be producing additional amount, you know, they are known to overproduce thyroid hormones. There would be a hyperthyroidism. And the hot nodules, they have higher likelihood to become cancerous.